ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're working our way through the Olivet Discourse, as it's called, the teaching that the Lord gave on the Mount of Olives. This morning we're in Matthew 24, looking at the verses 29 to 44. It's all about Christ's return. Well, returning is an occasion of life that many of us will experience in different ways. A winning team returns to its country after Olympic Games or some sports events, and there's a victor's parade. Family returns from holiday and they're hopefully refreshed and ready for their labours. You're away in work and you return and you're glad to be home. What will the return of the Lord Jesus be like? It is the next great event in history. So it's vital that we understand and find out as much as we can from the Word of God. The Bible says many things about it. It says in places that it will be visible, that it will be physical, that in Acts 1 and 11, as the disciples were told, as they saw him go into heaven, so they would see the Son of Man again. It will not be a secret coming of Jesus Christ. It will be public, and everyone will see it. And in these verses before us today, 29 to 44, the Lord is highlighting four things about his return. We saw last time in the opening part of this chapter the things that will go on in history before his return. Now when he comes to verse 29 to verse 44, he's telling them some things about that return. And we want to notice four in our passage. And these truths are not just simply to give us information. They are to stir us, they are to shape us, they are to shake us, and they are to sanctify us. I'm indebted in my understanding of this passage, and indeed the next chapter as well, as I said last Lord's Day, by the modern preacher and teacher and theologian Don Carson. So what will his return be like? Well, the first thing that the Lord tells his disciples about his return is that it will be in triumph. It will be in triumph. And now you need to look particularly at verses 29 to 31. That's what that little paragraph is telling you, that when Jesus comes again, it will be in triumph. It will be completely different from his first coming. His first coming was a coming of deep humiliation. He took human form. What great humiliation for the Son of God. He was like the little infants in our congregation, utterly dependent on his mother. He'd been born of a virgin. Oh, what a slight that put on him, as people didn't understand what had happened. All of his life he carried that burden. It was part of his humiliation. He was laid in a cattle trough for his crib. He had nowhere to lay his head, we're told in the scriptures. He had no money of his own to pay the temple tax, do you remember? He had people tell lies about him. He was flogged. He was crucified. He came in deep humiliation. Even today, the Lord Jesus is ignored by the masses. How many times did you have to cringe this week inside when you heard his blessed name be used as a punctuation and a swear term? But when he returns, it will be very, very different. Verse 9 begins immediately after the tribulation of those days. And those days that Jesus Christ is speaking about are the days that he has just been explaining, the days between his first and his second coming. After that, when those days have come to an end, days that we saw last time will be full of all sorts of difficulties and troubles for the people of God. But when those days have come to an end. And when he comes, he will come in victory. We're told immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Scripture tells us that creation just now is moaning and groaning because of the effects of sin in the world. And the Lord seems to be saying here that that same creation will recognize his coming. There will be a winding up of creation as we know it, as the new heavens and the earth come. All creation will recognize his coming. The sun and the moon give no lights. That part of the statement, darkness is always a statement in the scripture of God's judgments. And when he comes in victory and in triumph, he's coming to judge the living and the dead. He'll not be judged anymore by man when he comes. In his earthly ministry of those 33 years, everyone was judging him. They said things about him. He's the son of Beelzebub. He's a drunken, he's a glutton, he's the friend of tax collectors and sinners. They judged him and despised him. Today, men and women are judging him. He's of no importance, he's of no relevance in my life. But when he comes, he's coming in triumph, and he's coming to judge. And no one will doubt his majesty. Verse 30 says, Then will appear in heaven the sign of the Son of Man. It'll be difficult to know exactly what that means, and there have been different interpretations. I think many of them we can just simply rule out. Some of the church fathers thought that when Jesus Christ comes back, there will be some great cross shape appear in the heavens. It's obviously not that. Some would suggest that the sign that he's speaking here of is simply himself. I think the commentator Don Carson has a much better, more simple understanding. This sign, the word that's used, sign here, it can have the meaning of a banner. And not that Jesus Christ, when he comes, is going to be holding up a victor's sign, but it's simply a statement that when he comes, he will come as the victor, he will come in triumph. Of course, he's already the victor, isn't he? He's defeated sin and Satan and death at the cross. But in these days, between his first and second coming, we're awaiting his coming when all will note his victory. When he comes, all will recognize it's the coming of the living God. Then will appear the sign of the Son of Man. Then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. Scriptures, when they mention the clouds of the heaven, it's always a statement of the presence of God. So hear the Lord Jesus saying, I'm coming. And when I come back, I'm coming as the victorious, conquering king. And all the tribes of the earth will mourn. A great uncomfortableness will ripple out and engulf the hearts of men and women the world over, for all of their neglect and all of their despising of Jesus Christ as he comes in victory and triumph. Apostle John writes in Revelation 1 and 7, all tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. He's coming in victory. And every person that the Father gave to the Son will rejoice in that day, we're told in verse 31. And he will send out his angels with a loud trumpet call, and they will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. What a day it'll be for the children of God. You see that statement of the victory of Jesus Christ, this trumpet blast, and the angels, however that will manifest itself, gathering the elect, those whom the Father has loved in Christ for all eternity and given as a gift to the Son. And they'll be gathered in an instant, changed in an instant for the new heaven and earth. Little elect covenant children that didn't see the light of day will gather. The seas will give up their dead the elect gathered for heaven. Graveyards will give up their dead, the elect to be with Christ forever. Those who are still alive gathered, the elect for salvation, the unbelievers for judgment. And no one will ever, ever again take his blessed name in vain. All will tremble before him. He's coming in victory. Do you understand what that means for you, Christian? You live your life now on the winning team. The world tries to look down on Christianity, make Christians look small and insignificant. One day all will see that we've been on the victor's side. He's coming in triumph. It will be in triumph. Secondly, as we think of the Lord's return, not only will it be in triumph, but it will definitely happen. Just in case there's any little glimmer of doubt in your mind, it will definitely happen. You need now to look at verses 32 to 35. If you've been walking in the park, or if you have a garden and are looking out, you'll see the leaves are starting to fall. You know that autumn is coming. We're not particularly tuned into the world around us when we live in the city, but if you lived in first century Palestine, you were tuned into the plant world. Verse 32. From the fig tree learn its lesson. As soon as its branches become tender and puts out its leaves, you know that summer is near. You just had to look, see the little shoots appearing, and you knew it was definitely happening. And so with the Lord's return, it's definitely happening. Verse 33 is the key verse of this. For the Lord says, so also when you see all these things, you know that he's near at the very gates. Well, let me help you understand this a little bit more. You remember last time when we saw all of the events that must transpire in history before the Lord's return? We looked at the wars, the conflicts between nations. We looked at the so-called natural disasters of famines and earthquakes. We looked at the persecution of Christians that would happen, the spiritual decline that would happen, the gospel advance that would happen. And then the Lord Jesus, you remember, identified for them one great pain. He called these the birth pains. One great pain that would happen for these people, the fall of the city of Jerusalem in AD 70. And that fall of the city of Jerusalem was a little pointer to the close of all history, when the Lord Jesus Christ would come. And all of the things that the Lord Jesus had said would happen, wars and famines and persecutions, spiritual decline, gospel advance, they happened in those early decades, so that as the Christians could see them happening, they knew that this great event was going to happen in the fall of Jerusalem, just as the Lord had promised. And that was a little pointer to the end of time. And just as we look out in the history of the world and see everything happen just as Jesus Christ said it would, the wars, the famines, the earthquake, persecution, spiritual decline, gospel advance, we know that just as certainly as the fall of Jerusalem happened, that great pain, so the Lord Jesus will come in all his glory. Jesus says to these people on their day, truly, I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all these things take place. And they did at that time. In that generation, all these things happened before the fall of Jerusalem. And so we say too, all these things have been continuing to happen since the first to the second coming of Christ. And just as the fall of Jerusalem happened in certainty, so the Son of Man, the Lord Jesus Christ, will definitely return. Benjamin Franklin, American philosopher and writer, quipped, you've heard his little quip, I'm sure, there's nothing sure except death and taxes. Well, he wasn't quite right, was he? Because the Bible does tell us that when Jesus Christ comes, there'll be some alive at that time. And who knows what happens to our taxes. But there is one sure thing, that Jesus Christ is coming again. it is more sure than anything else in your life. You and I aren't sure of seeing this week out. You and I aren't sure of what'll happen in our work or what'll happen in our families. Haven't a clue. But we are sure that he's coming again. The Lord says in verse 35, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. All of his word, and this word about his coming again. Think of all the effort that you and I put in to make preparations for things in the future that might never happen. Well, what about this event? What about the certain event? Is your life, is my life, is it evident that we believe the word of God that Jesus Christ is coming again? All of these things that the Lord Jesus said would happen between the first and second coming of Christ, the wars, the famines, the persecutions, the gospel advanced, they could all be finished at any time. The elect gathered in. And his sure and certain return is to stir you and I up. It's to stir the person who's not yet a Christian to believe in Jesus Christ. It's to stir the Christian to get ready. Well, you would get ready for someone important coming to your home, wouldn't you? Is there some spring cleaning to be done in your life, Christian, before the coming of the Son of Man? He's coming in triumph. It will definitely happen. Then we see a third thing in our Lord's teaching in this discourse on the Mount of Olives about his return. It will be suddenly. Now you need to look at verses 36 to 41. So you can see this is right out of the Bible. Well, if someone's coming to your house, you like to know when they're coming, don't you? There's that last minute dash to put a few things away. There's somebody important. Well, with the Lord Jesus Christ coming, it's going to be sudden. People have been fascinated about the when of Jesus coming, haven't they? You go into some Christian bookshop and you find shelf after shelf of all, sadly, all sorts of nonsense in many places about the return of Jesus Christ in books. He's coming this century. The wars are telling us he's coming tomorrow. Well, these writers, and sadly many who preach sermons, could save themselves a lot of trouble if they believed the Bible. Because the scriptures are very clear about the Lord's coming. Verse 36. But concerning that day and hour, no one knows. Not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father only. So it's crystal clear. Why they waste their time writing books about this, I have no idea. Because God has said, nobody knows but the Father. So what do you make of that little phrase? I know there's a little phrase in that sentence or that verse that's just catching your mind now, and you're thinking, how does that work? Well, aren't you? Not even the angels, heaven, we can work that out. They're created beings. But then the Lord Jesus says, nor the Son. It's a bit of a puzzler, that, isn't it? If you're following your Bible translation probably has a little footnote beside the words, nor the Son. And the footnote will say something like, some manuscripts omit nor the Son. So you're not the only people to be puzzled by it. Some of the copyists of those early manuscripts were obviously a wee bit concerned about this phrase. But we know it should be there. And certainly in Mark chapter 12 and 32, it's recorded and it's utterly undisputed. Matter of the manuscripts. So how are we to unravel that? Nor the Son. Well, just two words, actually. Well, three words. With great care. With great care. Otherwise, you could get yourself into all sorts of error and heresy. Let me help you a little bit. Let me remind you of some statements. When you've got a little puzzling bit of the Bible, always get yourself to ground that you can nail down and you know from the Bible that solid point. Well, what do we know? Well, we know the Lord Jesus Christ, he is God and man in one person forever. You can nail that down, can't you? Lord Jesus, he's God and man, one person forever. We know that he didn't abandon his deity when he took, in addition to his deity, a human nature in one divine person. You got that nailed down, I hope? Didn't abandon his deity when he took, in addition to his deity, a human nature in that one divine person. So we've got two great nails hammered in. We know too that the Lord Jesus is the same in substance, equal in power and glory with the Father and the Holy Spirit. So we're nailing these things down, a bit like a climber climbing up and hammering in his little pitons, are they? Little things that open up and hangs his rope on so he's rock solid. We know too that the Lord Jesus lived his life in this earth in submission to the will of his Father. We know too from the scriptures that the Lord Jesus grew in wisdom and in understanding. And when it says that he didn't know the time of his return, one of the things that is saying to us is the statement of the depths of his humiliation. We know too from the and our confessions of the earliest days remind us of the wonderful nature of the Lord. His two natures, God and man, were perfectly united, not confused, not mixed, not divided, not separated. So I'm just hammering some rock solid truths in so that we can grasp a little bit of this that not even the Son of Man knows. Every morning I read a little bit of a volume of systematic theology. It's been my practice for decades. Reading volume at the minute by Beakey and Smalley. It's on page 811. Just came across this very recently. This is what they wrote. Explains it better than me. Christ's limited human mind was united to the person of the Son, who perfectly knew all things in his divine nature and shared with his human nature all it needed by the Holy Spirit to perform in the Father's will, to perform the Father's will flawlessly, but in a truly human way, with finite understanding. I'll read it again for you. Christ's limited human mind was united to the person of the Son, who perfectly knew all things in his divine nature and shared with his human nature all it needed by the Holy Spirit to perform the Father's will flawlessly, but in a truly human way, with finite understanding. Well, you say, that's too big for my mind. That's good. But God is so great, and our Savior is so great. But we try and stretch our minds to grasp a little more. This paragraph is saying to us, no one but the Father knows the day of the hour. So it's going to be sudden. And we're given an illustration in verse 37. For as with the days of Noah, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. What were the people doing in Noah's day? Well, we're told in verse 38. For in those days, before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying, giving in marriage, until the day when Noah entered the ark, and they were unaware until the flood came and swept them all away. So will be the coming of the Son of Man. Noah was speaking about it, but they didn't listen. And the flood came in an instant, and the door of the ark was closed in an instant. It was sudden. So will be the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And to further illustrate it, that point, the Lord says in verse 40, then two men will be in the field, one will be taken and one will be left. Two women will be grinding at the mill, one will be taken and one left. Oh, what nonsense has been written about those verses. I remember as a young Christian going into the assembly hall at school to see the latest film. Utter nonsense it was. I can still see the nonsense. Well, I'll not tell you about the film, but in case it gets into your head too. That Jesus Christ was going to somehow come very secretly and snatch people away, pilots out of aeroplanes and all the rest. What utter nonsense. It's a simple point that Jesus Christ was making. Just as he made about the coming of the floods, it would just be so sudden. Here are these women doing their work and just suddenly comes and one's taken to heaven, one's taken to judgment. The Lord was emphasizing how sudden it would all be. So there's no secret rapture, in case you've heard that. It will come so suddenly, and we're to live with that reality. There'll be people walking up and down the Woodstock Road, and he'll come. There'll be people watching their telly, and he'll come. There'll be people eating their breakfast or going to the work, and suddenly the Son of Man will appear. And surely we're saying, Lord, those things that I need to see to, give me grace to do. It will be in triumph. It will definitely happen. It will be suddenly, and then related to that, but slightly different for that, it will be at an unexpected hour. Now you need to look at verse 42 to 44. The logic is so simple, isn't it? He's definitely coming. He's coming in victory. He is coming suddenly. Therefore, verse 42 says, stay awake, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. Obviously, the Lord Jesus didn't mean that literally. Don't have to stay awake. It's to stir us up. It could be any time. So if you look at your life and you think, well, I've been dozing off spiritually, this is wakey, wakey time. And it's not a time to hit the snooze button of God's word. It's to hear it and to heed it. And to make sure we've got the point of his unexpectedness in his sudden return, the Lord gives this illustration, verse 43. But know this, that if the master of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Well, I hope you haven't had the experience of a burglary. Well, if you've heard of someone who's had, the burglar didn't send a text. The burglar didn't send an email. Didn't pop a letter through the post box the day before. Popping in Tuesday morning, 2 a.m., hope to get the car keys, a few other bits and bobs, thanks. No, for those who've experienced it, it was just so unexpected. They went up the stairs to bed. They heard nothing. They came down in the morning, and all their stuff was gone, and the car was gone. Nobody expected it. And the Lord says, that's how it'll be with the coming of the Son of Man. It will be sudden, and nobody will be expecting it. There'll be people stepping into the shower. There'll be people shaving at the sink. There'll be people sitting down to dinner. There'll be people doing the washing up. There'll be people in church. There'll be people in pubs. There'll be people heading out for the night. There'll be people going to the airport. There'll be people coming home from holidays. And suddenly, the Son of Man will appear with a host of his angels, and every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Verse 44 says, therefore, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. He's coming to judge the world. He's coming to divide the sheep from the goats. He's coming to cast into hell all who've ignored him throughout history. He's coming to save to the uttermost of our salvation for all who believed in him and loved him. He's coming to remove every hint of sin from the life of his elect, from his creation in the new heavens and earth. It's the Christian's blessed hope. He's coming. Let it shape you. If you're not a Christian yet, it's to call you to faith in Jesus Christ. For the Christian is to sanctify us. It's to help us rip off the old man and put on the new. It's to shake us from any spiritual lethargy that may have crept in. It's to fill the church with vigor after holiness in her midst, that she be prepared, the bride for the bridegroom. It's to stir the church to urgency in her witness. He's coming. He said himself at the end of his book, "Behold, I'm coming soon." The early Christians said it so often to one another. Even so, come Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, we sing to God's praise from Psalm 98. These verses mark 4 to 7. All the earth, to the Lord shout gladly. Sing forth, praise him and rejoice. To the Lord with harp sing praises, with the harp and tuneful voice. For to judge the earth he's coming, and with righteousness will he judge the world and all the peoples with most perfect equity. 98a, 4 to 7, we sing God's praise. Pages of your word today, that he's coming. We've heard it in the voices of our brothers and sisters as they've sung your praise. He's coming. We pray that this truth would shape us, make us bold in our witness, make us urgent in our sanctification. We pray that you'd bless your word to us, Lord. Let the changes not be momentary. Let them be for the rest of our days. Of people who live their lives with this glorious truth in our minds. Our gracious Lord and Savior, he's coming in triumph, coming in victory. He's coming surely, suddenly and unexpectedly. We bless you, mighty God. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of God, the Holy Spirit, be with you all. Amen.